I'd like to just welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us today as we approach the midpoint of our time together at this conference. I hope so far you're finding it informative, possibly inspirational, reflective, and more. And hopefully you've been able to meet people virtually at least and hear their stories and ideas and possibly the journeys that have brought everyone here. So I'll be hosting this session, our third webinar for this conference today. My name's Jonas. And before I introduce today's speaker, I just want to briefly touch on what this session will look like. So the speaker will share their ideas for the first 30 minutes. And after that, we'll be taking questions and possibly discussion from the audience. So there's two different ways you can ask a question. The first, you can just simply post a comment in the chat and I will read it out and ask our speaker the question. The second way is that you can raise your hand using the chat function to get my attention. So if you simply just click on the icon labeled participants at the bottom of your screen in the center, and then put the mouse over your name, and then just click on raise hand, or press any of the icons at the bottom of the participant tab. And then I'll call on you to ask your question. And before asking your question, feel free to introduce yourself and say a little bit about what you do. So you can do either of those two things depending on what you're comfortable with, and I'll let you know when the time comes when to do that. Lastly, I just want to remind everyone that we will be recording this webinar to be distributed amongst fellow participants and shared on social media. So if you have any problems about that at all, please do contact one of our conference organizers. You can use the email address creativeleadership@coforum.org. So now it's time to introduce our speaker. And I'm very excited to introduce Sonita Mbah. She is a youth empowerment and environmental activist who has worked in over 21 countries around the world to promote environmental sustainability and ecological protection. She has been the voice of African youths and communities at the UN climate negotiations, and she's also received a Gender Just Climate Solutions Award in Bonn in 2017 by Women and Gender constituency. She's been instrumental in the development of Better World Cameroon, an organization dedicated to bringing about a social transition towards a sustainable Africa, and which has championed and inspired climate adoption in Cameroon, Africa, and the international community. She's also a regional representative, a consultant and ambassador for Gen Africa, which is part of the Global Eco Village Network, which promotes social resilience, ecological protection, and environmental restoration by using eco villages as models for the development of sustainable communities. After creating a prototype in 2014, in 2018, Sonita took public Bruce Springs Cameroon, which is an NGO that develops community-managed water kiosks with catchment protection, with the aim of providing clean and affordable water to rural communities and supporting afforestation. Her pilot was successful in creating the first water kiosk that supplied water from protected springs in Bafut in the northwest region of Cameroon. Sonita is and has done many things. She is a facilitator, a trainer, an author, a communications professional, an activist, a student, a volunteer, and a leader. But above all, she is a conscientious and engaged young African changemaker. And it is my absolute privilege to welcome her here today. So without further ado, I will hand over to Sonita.
Oh, wow. It's not so easy to wait and just listen to you. Thank you so much, Jonas, and thank you so much to everyone present here today. And yeah, it's for me a very deep honor to be here and to be with you all and to share with you this afternoon or this morning, whatever the time is for you. And just wanted to check, can you hear me like very well? Or Great. So I have like a presentation to share with you, and I wanted to share with you these few slides, and I'm going to start to share my screen in a few minutes, but just so you're aware that you're going to have this flash of full screen in front of you, and so if you see that, please kindly you can exit the full screen so that you can still see me on the side of the window or a few people so that we don't lose sight of you. And I don't also want to lose sight of all of you. So I want us to have that connection. If you can see me, then of course I can also see you. So now I'm going to start sharing my screen. And yeah, I am... Yeah, I'm deeply touched to be with you here today, and I'm just going to go backwards because, and just also wanted to say that we are dealing here with technology, and if something isn't working, you shouldn't feel, don't feel nervous, just sit with it, please. Thank you very much. So our topic today is who we are is how we lead. And I'm going to be sharing and weaving inspiration, tools, and insights from Africa. And this is mainly from my work in the past years, as Jonas has rightly said. And also that I'm not going to be able to do justice to this topic in just 30 minutes or in a few minutes that we're going to be here today together. However, I'm going to do my best to bring across to you my experiences in this field and this topic, and also just to let you know that this is really grounded in my experience and my journey so far in my work in the world, and yeah, and that this is also very, very subjective, and there's a lot of other voices on this topic out there in the world, just to put that out there. Yeah, and yeah, who are you and what do you do? How do you lead? And I just wanted to say to you that I am here, I am African, I am Sonita, and I come from Bafut. This is who I am. And my culture, my identity as a Black woman has shaped me into the world to become who I am. And just to take a few steps back to say that I have grown in a community of people where we play around, where we sing songs, we dance, we jump around in the rain, and that every time that I have this discernment and this connection to this place, to this culture, I feel a deeper connection to myself. But also the liberation of oneself is about more the connection to trauma and to colonialism and all that has shaped me into being the person that I am in the world today. And knowing that I carry with me from birth a lot of trauma from colonialism, a lot of trauma that is sitting in the world today from racism, and that this is part of the assignment I have for myself to deepen this connection and to understand what it is that I can do to liberate myself from these different struggles, but also from gaining the light, from seeing the light beyond. Creative reconstruction of spirituality, and by this I have grown in something I call the spirit of Ndanifor. And the spirit of Ndanifor is a word from Bafut that means the house of funds, the house of chiefs. And house of chiefs means, for us in the organization in Better World Cameroon, it means that we come in a place of being with humility and integrity, but also with service to humanity. and with the responsibility to share and to give to so many people, what they find it difficult to gain, maybe from other places or from within themselves. So it comes from that place of deep sharing. But that my ancestry is about connecting myself to my roots and connecting myself to who I am, to my culture, to my traditions, to customs, and to the people all around me, to my environment. And that this is something that is not actually taught in school, so I really didn't learn it in school. But growing on the land, growing with my grandparents, growing in Bafut, shaped this narrative of my life. And for me, that connection to my ancestry, that connection to the spirit of Ndanifo, that connection to that deeper meaning of who I am, this is not about religion. This is just about the person that is sitting and talking to you today. Is I am carrying with me a lot. And a lot of ways that I have brought that in through my work is about, like I said before, reconnecting with the land, gardening, land use design, but also art and songs and dance. And most of the times, like, can you cook something? Can you cook a traditional meal wherever you are? Did you try cooking it for other people? And so when we do youth camps in our projects in Cameroon, we do something we call international cuisine, where people have to cook different kinds of food that connects them. And this is a sense, also a sense of being, a sense of connection to my roots, to where I come from. And then I create in some form an own narrative for this. And that narrative helps me to reshape different courses, educational courses, but also as a facilitator, I have to design from that place of being. And I have to design also from that place that shares different types of methodologies and pedagogies with different people, but that has the taste of Bafut, that has a taste of Cameroon, that taste of Africa, that touch of really who I am. And that's what makes me go into the world the way I am. And then I said here that support, of course, and this really means that it's not possible to do this alone. It's absolutely impossible. I have had an immense amount of support from many different people. But this also means that who has got my back? Is it my family? Is it some friends? Is it some mentors? There are a lot of people out there who have put me through this journey. And I'm just saying that whatever it is that I bring into the world has come from a place where I am grounded in Bafut, in my culture. And with this, I would take us into how we can then use this energy, how I did use this energy to serve community and the needs of community. And then I am sharing with you here different approaches and different tools. And for me, mostly it has been about valuing indigenous knowledge and wisdom, because the people, the local people, the rural people have grown in a regenerative structure. The world was not as destructive as it was today. And valuing whatever it is in service of what they have, of whatever they have put together, is a great tool to step into community. And in this way, also this means like doing agriculture projects, also permaculture projects. This means starting to acknowledging what the people have already done, the different kinds of agricultural system, and really seeing this as alternative systems, that they have started an alternative way of living. They have, that this is also really beautiful, and just take the time. Always I took the time to celebrate with the people and to acknowledge the gift and the wisdom that is existing in their environment, and also valuing that diversity, that even though I do come from Bafut and I am talking to Bafut people or people from Cameroon, and now today talking to people from different parts of the world, again, valuing that diversity and acknowledging that we come from a vast wealth of being, and just sit with that and understand, and also speak from that place of clarity, that Yes, I am somehow different. I'm absolutely not in terms of race, but in terms of where I've come from, experiences, and those different things have shaped me. And in many ways, also in my working community, there's different forms of that showing up. And there is religion, there is culture, there are strong traditions, but also there are government structures within community. And sometimes there are also people from the Western cultures, and there are people from the local culture, there are people from other African cultures, and to really grow with that. And in my work is where I have really done my best to be aware of village politics. And this is the web of communication that goes on within the village. The trauma points that are sitting there, and that being aware that before I start a project, before I do anything within any community, I start by acknowledging and trying to understand what are the processes the community has already gone through. What are the different conflicts that are sitting within that community? And in most cases, sometimes it's tensions around migration, it's ethnic tensions. And for me also, it has been really understanding this and grounding this into myself, into my work, in a way that I'm not so shocked when this shows up. Because most of the time, I realized also in the beginning, I was very, very conscious and deeply rooted into the work I was doing. And I just wanted to change the lives of people, you know, and not also being aware that in that process of changing mindsets and shifting things, those trauma points start to show up. And then there starts to evolve a lot of different kinds of conflicts. And when we already know this, we have a way of handling it. But also we start to do our homework. Our homework is to start dealing with that conflict within us, around us, and in our projects. I also always have to say that there are hierarchies within communities as well. And there are hierarchies also in the world. And in our work anywhere else, we have to acknowledge that. And this is one of the entry points into community, at least for myself, that to see, to acknowledge, to visit those people, to be there with them, and to actually bring the project to them, make them feel that, yeah, indeed, they are the hierarchy. And of course, there are also gender roles that play within community, and to acknowledge that. But that there are also different approaches that we can do in terms of working with community. And one of the ways that have actually worked quite well for me is to actually be local. I have traveled a lot, and a lot of us probably have as well. But when we are doing community work, to make, of course, insights and to make highlights to those different things that we have gathered from different parts of the world, those different cultures that excites people. However, be aware, I was always trying to be aware of the rank within myself, the rank existing in the community. And usually there's that tendency of saying, hello, in the US, this is how it's done. In the this is how it's done. However, what people really want to understand is what are the alternative systems? What are the different ways of doing it, and how can they incorporate it? They are not so much into the rank that we tend to build on into in the displaced. This is how it looks like. Also, another approach could be entry points, and those entry points are like leverage points. And for me, I go into a community and I observe it, and I look at, okay, where's the community at? Where's the journey of the community? Is it in agriculture? Is it in social lifestyle? Is it in marketing? Where is it that the easiest place where I can make a difference with the least input, with the least effect? And then I would have more outcomes. So to, first of all, highlight those different areas and to see what are the ways then to make those entry points. And to create within that support systems. And those support systems are also within the net, within the community, within the project. For me, mostly, I have had elders, women in the community support network, where I live within the community, and then I go to visit, not because of a project, just to go and visit a grandma. And you know, grandmothers, they just need someone to complain to and to go to her. And then she starts to say, oh, Sonita, you know, my back is paining, oh, my neck, oh, there's even this church contribution, I don't even have the money. You know, this is just also part of the work. But what I realized at the end of the day is that this mama is a great support system for me, because sometimes I'm really so stressed, I'm really so tired, and then I go to her, and then she's there with her arms open. And then sometimes, you know, also there's also village gossip, and then we can gossip around just like that. However, this work, a lot happens. It could sound so exciting as I just narrated it, doing different activities, different programs, but then a lot actually happens where there are lots of challenges that we face and we hit roadblocks. And in my case, sometimes it has been around indigenous knowledge systems that I have worked with a lot. And I'm talking about systems around ecology, ecological building systems, where we are using the earth. We are refining and making bricks and actually using our palms, our feet. We are really getting dirty, but we're using the knowledge of the elders, how it was done before, and we are adding like modern day technology onto that to adapt it, to refine it, to suit the current standards. And then we have most of the time tension also with our international partners, who feel that that there is pressure to adopt this Western systems, because most of the indigenous knowledge systems are not scientifically proven. And I remember that also most of the time in my work, it was hard when I was asked the question, so how much quantity of this? And a typical example is also like recipes. In Europe and in other parts of the world, I know that like recipes are such a crucial thing. You need to know how many cups and how many spoons of tea of salt to put in. But you know, in Africa, this is really so far-fetched. And so we're really not very good at measuring stuff. And so I just understand it as that grounded, you know, that spirit that leads me. And I just understand it also from that place, as I explained before. And so it's quite hard to explain how that all fit into today's changing the climate and bringing emergency and all of these systems into place. But some of the ways that I have managed to deal with that are also here on the slide, which we can look at a bit later. There also I wanted to talk about cultural norms. And so when I talked about grounding in culture before and grounding in traditions, and this is about really honoring that they are part of our culture, part of our traditions that we should be proud of, that I am proud of as a young person. But also they are part of those cultural norms that really breaks us apart. And I wanted to just also highlight a few of them, of those cultural norms, for example. For example, in one of the workshops I had in the community, it was actually about the water project, as Jonas said in the beginning. And this water project, we had to build the catchment, and we were having like a meeting with the community and starting to talk about how we want to shape this project. And then someone in the, some elder, a great man with wisdom in the community, he said, "Actually, Sonita, I should be the one to manage the money. You should bring the money to me. I need the money. We all need to know. We don't need you to come here with those cameras, take photos of us, go back and make money." So in a way that a lot of the times elders in our community feel like kind of resistance, also with young people, but also they feel like a bit disrespected when they're spoken to directly, because I have grown in a culture where we have to speak and we have to put our heads down, also as a woman. and to actually say this right straight on, and to be in this place and in this meeting and actually say, this is not possible because the money has to be managed according to the requirements of the donor, and that it's not possible to negotiate that. But also that sometimes we have cultural norms, like as a woman, as a young person, and even a leader working a lot with community, I cannot cross my feet in front of elders. I cannot just sit and cross my feet. And also I cannot talk to our local authorities, or like there's one photo here with the man who is standing with his arms like this with his colorful dress. If you can see it, he wears a lot of knowledge, but that is the king of Bafut, and he has an amazing palace that covers over 200,000 people. And it's not possible as a woman also to talk to these people directly, even when you are working in community. Also, as a young person, my professionalism is also quite questioned sometimes in the very beginning when I started this work. And I have to work really hard and to justify and to express like how worthy my ideas are. However, it is really, really overwhelming to combine work, self, and relationship, especially. We need to make like a balance between the two, and most of the times in my work also, there has been like a lot of tough work, also agriculture, and this is really physical work, and sometimes really overwhelming to deal with staff at different levels, representing communities on the ground and working on the land and supporting communities, supporting young people, supporting myself, having to live my life at the same time, representing different projects at UN conferences. In different countries, doing network building, and just having to understand the amount of work that accumulates over time and how that slowly overwhelms me. And that also sometimes breaks us into different parts, and we find it really hard to come together and to find that space of balance in between. And most of the times when I face these challenges, I had to do a lot of journaling. I've had to write down a lot to structure, but also I've had to meditate, like sometimes 1 hour a day, for so many years, on the early hours of the morning, just to stay insane, just to be able to manage somehow this level of massive amount of stuff to deal with, but also to manage at a mental level, the amount of stress and trauma that comes with it. And just to share that sometimes it feels like the world comes crashing. And then I need to stay clear again with myself. And then I have to pray a lot and do a lot of yoga. And think and listen is something that I learned. And this is about when I feel really overwhelmed, or when I have like a struggle around cultural norms, I have a struggle around with pressure from the different partners of our project, then I can go to someone, to a friend, and I can do it, think and listen with this person, and this person just practice deep listening. And I share like the burden of what I have inside of me. I share it with this person. I express my deep connection also, but the deep pain and the deep joy within me. And sometimes also at the end to say, what would I have done differently if I were to repeat this case again, or if I were to go back into this scenario, what would I do differently? Also, many times I seek advice from different people. I practice, I have like some different tools. There's one called dragon dreaming. Such short time to talk about it, but if you have the time, please check it out. I like it a lot because it talks about celebration and the need to celebrate whatever the situation. And so sometimes, no matter how difficult the day is, just to take that step and then to celebrate, even if it's a cheers over a glass of wine. But sometimes it really pushes me to think out of the ordinary, and when I designed different programs, for example, when I designed the HVAP program in Cameroon, and HVAP means high value agricultural product program, and this is because of the challenges we were facing, mostly about indigenous knowledge systems, because their indigenous knowledge system at that time was on regenerative agriculture, and regenerative agriculture mostly is just about growing traditional staple crops. People really didn't know how to do it differently. But with high value agriculture program, it's about integrating high value products into the normal farms, into the traditional staple crops, so that those different products that are high value, also most of them have like nitrogen fixing, quite strong agroforestry technique, where you intercrop and then there's nitrogen fixing that strengthens the roots of the plant, strengthens the being of the different traditional staple crops. However, we're not wasting the land, and then the people have to harvest the different products. They would feed from them, sell some. But the high value products fetch more money, so the people end up with more money. At the end of the day, I need to breathe, you know, just find a place and disappear and just breathe. And more of those challenges, you know, gender roles. And gender roles is one of those things that I can just not escape it as a woman. And that in most cases in my work, my vulnerability has come ahead of impact. And sometimes I've even had to battle over how much I have to be paid. And then another colleague who is a man, how much he has to be paid, even when his workload is less. So having to be seen most of the time as a secondary gender. Sometimes I just, when I face situations like this, I engage in an open dialogue whenever it's possible. Most of the times it's not possible. And sometimes I let that go and I wait later on to engage in that conversation at the time when I feel like really, really maybe happy, because I could also go blow out of proportion. But sometimes I really bring it to the awareness of the other people in the room even before the conversation starts. And I remember there was this time I had a very strong job negotiation with some different people, mixed group of people, Westerners but also Africans, and I was the only woman, and there were like six men in the room, and you know, and I just said, let's do an attunement. And in that attunement I was like, okay, so let's also sit here with the awareness that there's just one young woman and there are six men in the room, and let's sit with that energy of masculinity around us. And sometimes this helps to bring that awareness in the room and could shift the atmosphere a bit, because otherwise it's really hard to deal with. Sometimes I just let go. Other times I count my battles and see which one I have to fight, which one I have to just go away from. And we cannot fight all the battles. I can't fight all the battles in my work. Other times it's really disheartening that youths also feel like intimidated. And sometimes, of course, young people have told me, like, we are waiting to see what man you would marry, or we are waiting to see what kind of woman you would become, that even if you will marry, we don't know which man will want to marry a career woman. Sometimes they would call me, oh, Mama English, you like English too much, you know. So, yeah, I mean, it's very provocative, but I understand that it is an environment of intimidation. And for me, I've really tried to be aware also of my rank and how I project that on other people, and even after having done, of course, a lot of work. And to realize again and again that this is about supporting each other through it, and that as young people, we really need to give each other the support we need. We are all on the same team. We are all working towards the same objective, you know, resolving the current issues in the world. You know, the issues of climate change, the issues of women and gender, issues around, around the environment. Yeah, but also I sometimes give it time, just give it time and space. Yeah. And as we move on, I wanted to share with you at this point, I'm quite unaware of how we're doing with time. I wanted to share with you, the learning journey going forward. And by going forward, I actually mean looking inside of us. Because the future is actually really inside of us. The future is here. And how I look at the future and how I would love us to look at the future as creative leaders that we are going to be, or that we already are, is about learning and sharing of new ideas. What has inspired me so much in the last years is peer-to-peer learning. So many exchange programs that I have led, but also the connection with other young people from different cultures, different places, the different ideas, that they embody, that they carry with them. I learn a lot all the time from these different ideas, but every time we share those ideas, it's like a huge library. And this is really changing the lives of many people. It's changing my life. And the more we share such ideas, the more we share such stories, also creating platforms that enables us to share and to bring each other into that space of co-creativity. In my work, I've done this mostly through the youth camps, through different multi-stakeholder workshops, sometimes sharing different tools, bringing different pedagogic ideas to different groups of people. We can do it differently, but also creatively. And the second one is about interconnectedness. And interconnectedness is holistic perspective, the holistic perspective of culture, of economy, of social and ecology. And this is really about understanding where we are, the work we are doing, and how it is connected to everything around us. And I do this, of course, through the eco-village process of culture, economy, social, and ecology. And this keeps me really aware of what is the next solution I'm bringing on the table? How does it work in the cultural context? What is the economic component? What is the social component? And what is the ecological component? What is the creative measure that I have that allows the different systems around to interconnect in a beautiful way with whatever design that I am sharing? But interconnectedness in a way that goes beyond, without any form of discrimination, creating a beauty, a project that actually looks at all forms of things in a holistic way. And the next one is about interbeing. And interbeing is something also very special to me. And this is about being on and underneath the earth, life on and underneath the earth. And just that awareness that we as single humans with just one single nervous system, it's not possible. We are super, super connected. Whenever I sit and I talk about Bafut, I feel like I just made a travel to Bafut. We are so interconnected in our being with everything else in our environment. And every time that I want to create something, I have to tap into that resource of what is it that exists in the world? What are those other beings that I'm not just the selfish being without realizing that there's so much more that I am stepping on and that I am crushing without knowing? Just to bring that awareness, and usually the way I describe it is about being like a magnet. And this magnet is us as leaders, and then we attract the iron filings. And those iron filings, we don't have to go rush for them or fight to get them, but we create systems in a way that actually just attracts those iron linings, and the system flows with each other in a very smooth way, just weaving things like a divine plan. And that is me, and that is my journey, and I hope that you really have felt inspired by it. And I just wanted to let you know that the most powerful leadership tool you have is your own personal example, because our personal example is who we are, and that is then how we lead. That is whatever we do, wherever we go to, wherever we come to, this is where we come. We come to ourselves. And I have realized that in my work so far, whenever I am in like high level political forums, it's so difficult to speak in these places. It's so challenging to stand up also as a young person and address a huge crowd of people. And that most times what has helped me or supported me is to just sit there and to sing a song from barefoot, or to say some words from barefoot. And that allows me to connect to ground again and to make that mental imaginational transition back to barefoot. Yeah, and thank you all very much, and I look forward now to your questions, and I'm going to now turn off or stop sharing my screen so that I can see you again. It just felt really strange not seeing you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Sonita, and I hope everyone will join me. I hope everyone will join me in thanking Sonita for sharing with us today. So we're now going to move on to the moderated section of the webinar. And as we mentioned earlier, if you have any questions or anything you'd like to discuss, you can do that in one of two ways. You can either ask a question in the chat, or you can raise your hand by clicking on the participants tab at the bottom of your screen. And then I will come to you and you can ask your question directly. So either of those two ways are available to you, whichever one you feel most comfortable with. So I see we already have a question from Angelica.
Hello, Sonita. You are really, really inspiring. And I have one question for you. How do you manage the emotions and feelings they give when interacting with the community? Because sometimes it's positive, and in some ways are negative when you do not agree with something that you see, but is of their culture. How do you continue with the project and with your life?
Do I have to answer it directly, or we just take more questions? I cannot hear you, John.
You can answer it directly, and then we can move on to the next one.
Oh, okay. Not easy at all, because you're dealing also with people, and most of the times, I would just say I seek advice from elders in the community, also within our project. I seek advice on how to deal with different things. I have to acknowledge I can never deal with it on my own. I could never do it on my own. And sometimes what has happened is how the entry point has helped to help a lot is usually before you start before I start the program, I talk first the objective to the leader of the community. And then I convince the leader to understand what is the real desire and the intentions of that activity. And then when there is a tension that rises, I go to that leader, and because he already has that understanding, I speak with him, and then he steps in to address the situation with that background, and I don't have to be the one doing it. And then when the people listen from one of their elders and one of the people within your community, and this person also speaks in the local language, then things kind of just cool down.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So we had another question from Nick on the chat, who asked, how do you see the transformation of culture evolving, both in Cameroon and beyond? And how do you feel, and the part you feel you play in that?
The transformation of cultures. I think that each culture is really unique, and that each culture has a place, and that no culture is supreme to any other culture. And I really believe, again, in what I said, interconnectedness, and that we are all somehow interconnected with each other, whether we like it or not, in our nervous system. And when we look at COVID-19, we are all super connected. And the transition of cultures in the world would also depend on our individual transitions. And I see that us as human beings, when we look inside of us, inside of me, the role that I have to play with this on this is about my own awareness and working on my own inner work and realizing that I don't have to make projections on other people or, you know, quote them as racist or whatever. And that how that culture transforms or transitions within me is also how it would in somehow within another person. However, I think it's work that we all have to do within and inside of us, and that then comes on the outside.
Fantastic, thank you. So we have another question from Heather, who's going to ask a question via video.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Sonita. I just had one question for you. Regarding some conflicts that you faced before, for example, you were talking about when you were young, you were told that you were unprofessional. How did you handle that with grace and without shutting down? Because I know I'd be really discouraged by it.
Yeah, I know so many of us young people, I am still a young person. I was just much younger in the journey at that time. I think I learned how to give and receive feedback. And this is also a very key thing in leadership, is how we receive feedback and also how we give feedback, because we can give feedback in a very constructive way and others could not give it to us very constructively. However, how do we receive it? How do I sit and just take this as a container without fighting back? And somehow I had to build within me the strength to withstand this. And this, I would say, meditating has a lot to do with it. That a lot of the times when I just stand in front of someone and they just hit like really strongly, and I don't say a word, and then I turn back and all I do is meditate and sit in silence, because this just grounds everything and flushes it away. Otherwise, I would just, I think, collapse or something.
Thank you. So we have another question from Hajar, who says, elders are so important within the community. How do you balance between respect and the truth that they sometimes need to hear?
Yeah, most of my friends will tell you that I always say that the elders are my problem with them is that they're always looking at the past. And as young people, we want to look at the future or the present. And the elders, all they tell us is, you know what, in those my days, this is how it looked like, and this is how it looked like. And your days are gone. Now I just want to live the future. And so this is really, really difficult. And I have understood it in this way, really. I have understood that the tension with the elders comes because us as young people, we're just looking at now, we're looking at tomorrow. And they are still really living in the past, and they are still carrying the glory of the past. And that glory of the past is really what ignites them. And so if I always start to tell them like stories of the past, then they are super happy. Then they are super excited. But sometimes they really have little to contribute with the future. And not to force them to do that, because I just really try to understand this and not create that tension, and to just listen to their wisdom, whether it comes from the past or whatever, and to understand how I can use that wisdom to move forward with it.
Interesting. I have a question here from Vivi, who wants to know, what has been your experience of bringing more holistic and authentic ways of being or doing things into formal spaces, for example, high-level political forums?
You guys have really difficult questions, huh? I think it is a very difficult transition. I have just seen myself as that person that is in the middle, that I feel really, really upset, for example, with the war that is going on in Cameroon, and a lot of people are super upset with French government and everything. Yet I was in France, in Paris, and I was like, oh my God, I don't wanna do this. so I don't know, like, it's just too edge of something, you know? And then there are just some people like us who have to just bridge it in between. And that part, bridging it, needs some skills. First of all, I would say I really needed to accept within me that I cannot just say what is just my voice. I have to tap from a deeper source. And that deeper source is also like from the people, from the projects on the ground, and speak from that place of grounding. Really represent the voice of the people and not my voice. Talk about the projects, and all the time I have spoken in these different places, I'm either talking about the practical solution on the ground in a country in Africa or in my own project, and then bringing that international, those contributions from those platforms back to those projects. And it's hard to bridge the two, because sometimes the people in the international forums, they don't get it. These are tiny little solutions. They're not gonna change the world. We want large scale technology. And then when you bring the connection from the high level forum back to the people, and you're like, okay, does this brand new technology, it's called solar. They're like, what is that? So it needs some, I would say, a twist of language sometimes. I really had to change, for example, permaculture. I wouldn't call it permaculture in the community. I would really change it into a decoded language that the people would understand. I would say farming, where you make sure that it is lasting for a very long time, it's more sustaining. I would not just give it the word that is given in the high level forum, and vice versa.
And we just have one more follow-up question, somewhat related to Vivi, related to the last question from Vivi. She said, have you seen conversations about colonization / decolonization in the eco-village movement?
Wow. I would say that people have touched this. It's a big container of trauma that we have only touched. We caress all the time the corners of the container. We don't actually dive into the container. We just caress it a little bit because it is really painful. And because I think as humans, we've just been nurtured to run away from trauma. So nobody really wants to dare that and go into it. And so all the time we just really do touch the surfaces of it, and then we feel really how painful that is, and then we step away. And I believe that someday we would actually really jump into it. We would not have a choice.
So I'll just ask one more question. You mentioned the importance of creativity, and I just wanted to know if you could expand a bit more about the creative and how important is that to connect and engage with the spirit or with ourselves?
Yes. I didn't prepare for these questions. So I think that so far, even within me, I have done a lot of work with anticipation. And I think what the current word is showing to us is that we can no longer just anticipate things. I can no longer just anticipate. I think I'm currently living in a world of huge unknown, like there's all this unknown stuff out there. And I cannot touch it, I can only feel it. I can feel that it is unknown. So this is also calling me to be creative in different ways. And this is creativity, like imagination. And so what I actually use is, again, this different, the last three concepts that I talked about, combining economy, ecology, culture, and social, that most of the times I really have to just think and imagine things. And then once I imagine them, I try to put them in that box. And I try to look at, so this thing I just imagined, what is the cultural benefit of it? And that cultural benefit, where does it sit? Maybe sometimes also, is it something really I can touch? Is it something physical? Is it connected to Cameroon or to Bafut? Where can I touch it in that context? And then I would look at the ecology. But mostly for me, the ecology part has been quite easy. Maybe because I worked a lot on the land, but it is just one thing that we can so connect with. We can just connect to the earth, we can connect to, and sometimes just the land gives us a lot of inspiration. And what I would say about creativity is just listening to that inspiration and connecting to intuition. And then somehow in the middle, we create new things. I don't know if that answers your question or it's clear enough, but it's really not something I can explain. Like when you're just so inspired and you're so empowered, things happen. And you're so aligned, then you dream. And you create new things, I think.
Fantastic. I think that's a lovely note to end on. So I just want to once again thank Sonita for attending and for sharing her ideas and her story with us. I think she's given us a lot to think about, a lot to reflect on, finding out more about who we are and where we come from. What's our history? Can we come to terms with our past to free ourselves and take ownership of our future? And how can we find balance in our lives, help ourselves find peace? And I hope in the future we can all take time to question ourselves, question our assumptions, connect with other young people, share ideas, and don't be afraid to question ourselves. How much do we really know about who we are? And if we can begin to answer that, then maybe we can begin to understand the potential we have as leaders for change. So once again, thank you, Sonita. Thank you everyone for attending, and have a wonderful rest of the day. And see you in the rest of the conference. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jonas. Thank you to Creative Leadership. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.